Hey there. This week we're talking about fear and the messages of fear and shame that may have been around us growing up or when we started thinking about being LGBT and how that may have impacted and whether we overcame that or and if we did, how did we do it? It's such a huge topic. When I started thinking about it, I was thinking, wow, this is there is a lifetime of this. The first time I ever associated shame and fear with LGBT status, I was extremely young. I was like, I think I was like 7, was the first time it ever happened. And it was very much a child's interpretation of what was going on rather than the actual reality of the situation. There was this man that was assaulting children in the area where I lived. And I didn't really understand what sexual assault was. I didn't even know what the problem was at the time. I just knew that we had to, if we were going to wander off, we had to do it with our friends, that we shouldn't be alone because at that point in time it wasn't safe for whatever reason. And the police eventually found the guy and he was charged. I'm giving you the short version. He was charged with 27 counts of child sexual assault. The community itself that we were living in had a lot of socioeconomic issues. It was poor. The legal representation that they used was not great, and the justice system is as good as the money that you have. And the person who was charged had a reasonable amount of money and had extremely good legal representation. And to cut a long story short, he walked on all 27 charges. He was never convicted. And a week later, when we went to school, he was hanging in the playground. So someone had decided in the community to take this upon themselves and take it into their own hands and had murdered him. And when the police investigated it, they came to this conclusion that more than one person had done this, like at least 2 people were responsible for this crime. And when that information came out to the community, 300 men from the community went into the police station, handed themselves in, and confessed that they had done it. I don't think even one of those 300 men had any idea who had done it, you know. But the point was that regardless of whether a confession is authentic or not, it has to be fully investigated by law. So they held up the investigation for years and years and years and years, and then it had to be dropped, so no one was ever charged. Now, what the intention of all the people involved in that, whether you agree or disagree with it, because it sort of touches on all those vigilante issues, their intention was to protect children. However, the speak around the community, now this man had assaulted both boys and girls. It had nothing whatsoever to do with sexuality. It had nothing to do with heterosexuality. It had nothing to do with homosexuality. But people kept referring to him as queer. And because of my age and because I had no concept of sexuality, it solidified this thing in my mind that queers were somehow deviants, you know, that brought harm upon people. So that's like the first time I remember thinking it. In terms of my own family, my father worked in hospitality. He worked as a chef. There was a lot of gay people around at a time when it was not necessarily okay to be gay. And so I didn't really get the message from them that this is a negative thing, but I did get the message from them that this is a very difficult way to live. And that would continue. You know, I can't even begin to tell you the amount of violence I've seen against LGBTQ people, both completely random violence and violence during protests and marches for LGBTQ rights. You know, we certainly didn't get here easily. And that was very much imprinted on my brain as a young person. I was never part of what was deemed to be society, I guess. And we moved a lot. We moved between countries. So, but that didn't make any difference. The stakes just got higher or lower. It was never acceptable. It was never this sort of sense of belonging, which I think impacted on my life a great deal. There are kind of positives to that too, though, because it was like I met, you know, being a fringe dweller, some amazing people that were also kind of in that category that I never would have met otherwise. But yeah, there was a very much this whole process. In fact, right up until I was about maybe 30, there was an awful lot of fear and shame and angst around LGBT status and whether I should be out to people or not out to people, all this other carry-on. And I think how you overcome that, I think part of me probably hasn't overcome that. I can smell violence a mile away. If you walk around with me, you'll probably never get assaulted because I can see it coming and know the first exit. And fear, I think, in the wider sense, it's gone out of control in the world. It's completely crazy. So much is driven by fear that it's almost this explosion of craziness, you know. And at some point, I realized, and I'm not even entirely sure what point that was, is that the worst thing you can do is ignore fear. Because fear is a little bit like physical pain, like when you have physical pain, that's a warning. So the danger in switching that pain off, so say you, I don't know, hurt your ankle, so have some inflammatory things, you go and you take anti-inflammatories, you take painkillers, and then you run around because, hey, you know, you switch the pain warning off. And now you've injured yourself further because you turned that warning off and you didn't know that you're causing further injury. And I think pain and fear are quite similar in that way. The worst thing you can do is ignore fear. You know, the only way to overcome fear is to hit it head on and acknowledge it, because fear is a warning. It keeps us safe. And the flip side of that is that fear is the most destructive emotion. You only need to own a television to know that. Nothing will eat you up faster than fear, and nothing will kill you faster than fear. So, and I've very much, I don't know how I arrived at this, but even from a young age, it was like I would acknowledge that fear. I'd never, ever go, oh. In fact, the only times I haven't acknowledged that fear, I've become physically unwell, you know. It's not about whether you're afraid or even if you're terrified. Like, even if I'm terrified, I'll sit there and go, okay, I'm terrified. Now I'm going to do this anyway. So to some degree, the only way to deal with it is to say, here is this fear. Is this a reasonable warning? Or am I just going to say, okay, I'm afraid, and move on and do whatever it is, you know? Shame is a much more difficult one, because shame kind of seeps, and often you don't even realize that what you're having is a shame reaction. I think true shame, though, I've only ever really felt when I've gone and done something pretty stupid that I probably should be ashamed about. The other kind of shame is much more surface, like, okay, these people are not okay with who I am and I need to do something about that, whether that be leave, stay, explain myself, whatever. But there's so much of this stuff that the LGBTQ community carries that I don't think I could do it in a few minutes. But it's a great topic. It's worth thinking about it. It's worth thinking about it for yourselves. So, you know, we some of your reactions come from, and whether you still need to hold on to them or not. Anyway, have a wonderful weekend. I'll see you next week.